Hey, so before I start this video, I just want to mention that this video took a while for me to make. Not that that means that the video is different in quality or anything, it's the same old bullshit. I just sat on the script for a while and procrastinated finishing it until now. I started scripting this video in March of 2020 and filmed it all in September of 2021, and because of certain events that have happened since then, I just want to mention how heartbroken I was to find out that both Jim Steinman and Meat Loaf had passed away. Their music has meant the world to me, and they are some of my favorite musicians of all time. I do crack some jokes in this video, but they are meant to be taken in a lighthearted way. In short, I just want to say thank you for the music. It has meant the world to me and millions of others. The beat is yours forever. Also, because of the way how YouTube works, I wasn't able to play any of the songs I am talking about in this video without the video being blocked in X amount of countries. So if I say this song sounds like this song, you're just gonna have to imagine it. I've cited everything I've used as sources in the description below, so if you need any extra context, it's down there for additional research. So sorry about that. Kind of defeats the purpose of the video, but I did the best I could. Now, with that out of the way, let's get on with the video. In case you didn't know, Meat Loaf's ghostwriter, Jim Steinman, is responsible for writing many of his most popular songs, such as Bat Out of Hell, Paradise by the Dashboard Light, I Would Do Anything for Love, But I Won't Do That, Objects in the Rearview Mirror May Appear Closer Than They Are, I Want to Eat Your Pancreas. Wait, that last one isn't a Steinman song. And if you notice anything about these songs, it's that they share a similar, unique style, whether it be lyrical style, or even down to the way certain chords or riffs are written. And if you're a professional Meat Loaf fan or old people music aficionado like myself, you would notice that many of these songs appear multiple times throughout history. It slowly becomes more of a, wait, that riff is from that song, and you wouldn't be too far from the truth because Jim Steinman is the king of Control C plus Control V. He's like copy paste repeat from the internet in you. Now, I already know what you're thinking. Meat Loaf didn't write all of his own songs. This Jim Steinman is just a copycat. Is Meat Loaf the classic rock version of Drake? No, and let me clarify. Jim Steinman is a composer, songwriter, musician that has written many songs for artists throughout the 70s and 80s, as well as many plays too. And by writing songs for some artists, I mean sometimes writing entire albums for some artists, which there is nothing wrong with. As long as we get good music at the end of the day, I don't care who wrote it. The one thing I began to notice the more and more the deeper I dug through Jim Steinman's catalog is that not only are there different versions and covers of his songs by different artists, but there are also some of his songs that have been changed and altered slightly throughout time, even having name changes at some point. It's like when you find Tataka's song in a Nintendo game, but you realize his entire discography is like that. The best way I can explain this is that it's like your teacher handing back your report only for you to make one or two corrections and then turn it back in, except he did a damn fine good job at doing it and made hella money in the process. Alright, let me start you off with an easy and less convoluted example of the kind of copy-paste-repeat I'm talking about. Did you know Jim fucking Steinman, as I like to call him, wrote Total Eclipse of the Heart? But did you know that the song was later reworked into a song about a vampire falling in love with a human for the German play Tanz der Vampire as Totale Finsternis? Hell, some of the lyrics of the song date back to 1969, but I'll talk about that later. Or how about the ascending crescendo choir, I think, in Stark Raving Love was later used in Holding Out for a Hero. After discovering these little Easter eggs in the songs, I was on a mission to find the origin of most of Steinman's songs. And when I say most, there's a lot to dig through. I got to the point where multiple spreadsheets were made. I'm talking about some of these ideas and rough drafts that go back decades and decades. This is the exact reason why I'm chronologically confused about the origin of Jim Steinman's songs. I did over 40 hours of research for this video, but I know I'm missing details here and there. Trust me, I'm going to miss some stuff that only 5 of you diehard Meat Loaf and Steinman fans actually care about, but there's plenty of information in this video to make you snore, so don't worry, just let me vent. Now let me just say I've been around this site a couple of times. I went to YouTube University, and because of that, I'm contractually obligated to start from the beginning. In 1969, Steinman graduated college and wrote the book, lyrics, and music for The Dream Engine. Let me just say that since this play was performed over 45 years ago, and at this point has evolved through many drafts, it is very hard to find a sufficient amount of consistent information. Luckily, the channel MLBF Collection on YouTube uploaded the only known audio performance of the play in its entirety that I can find, so thank you for that. Forgive me, but I haven't sat down and listened to the entire play, but from the articles I was able to find on Steinman's own site, the plot to The Dream Engine is as follows. The plot was roughly Charles Manson the musical, although without the evil of the real Manson. The Dream Engine actually preceded the Manson killings by a few months, a very weird presence on Steinman's part. The plot is, a group of runaway young people melds themselves into a tribe. reveling in excess and animal physicality in a remote part of California. Their leader is a charismatic, amoral poet named Baal, played by Steinman himself. Eventually, the wicked forces of the city try to find and destroy them. The tribe returns to the city and burns it. In the end, everyone is dead, a pile of bodies except for Baal. Keep in mind, I found this article after I skimmed through the script, and yeah, it's definitely morbid, and there are a lot of naked performers, as well as the spice of some outdated profanities. A very dark start to Steinman's career in a direction that he wouldn't take later on, so bear with me. This is the same man who wrote a song called Dance in My Pants, so I think there's a light at the end of this rabbit hole. It's hard to grasp a play without the visual aspect, but I was able to spot some bits and pieces of songs that would evolve into later Steinman works. And just so you know, I'm going to be referring to songs and parts of the play as referred to as they are in the timestamps of the original uploader's description on the video, so let's get started. Remember the example from earlier about Total Eclipse of the Heart? Well, bits of the song actually originate from a song on the Dream Engine. In the portion of the play labeled The Invocation and Formation of the Tribe, Come in the Night / Skull of Your Country, the character Baal recites a draft from the Turnaround Exchange that is later heard in Total Eclipse of the Heart. The same song was later reworked and edited into simply Skull of Your Country on Meat Loaf's 2016 album Braver Than We Are. Who Needs the Young, which was later made significantly more well-known with the Bat Out of Hell musical, also originated from the Dream Engine. It was also re-recorded for Braver Than We Are and Steinman's 1977 play Neverland, which we'll cover in just a second, so bear with me. And you know the long-winded, unskippable monologue from You Took the Words Right Out of My Mouth, Hot Summer Night? Well, it also originates from the Dream Engine as an exchange between Steinman's character, Baal, and a female character. It is a bit jarring after having this monologue ingrained in my brain for so many years, only to have it followed up with a song called Ride the Cock Horse. In Act 2, the intro, Pyro Hymn to Fire, is similar to the same riff Steinman includes on Stark Raving Love and Holding Out for a Hero. Again, I haven't listened to all of the Dream Engine, so forgive me if I missed any other similarities from songs in it to other future Steinman songs. From what I have heard, it was rather interesting as a fan to look back and see what would become of these drafts, especially hearing the introduction to Hot Summer Night. It was weird not hearing the drums hit right after the last line in the monologue. I also like the Deep Purple-inspired grunge these songs had to them compared to the lavish recording style Steinman would later have access to. With the Dream Engine out of the way, we have to go forward to 1973 to discuss Steinman's next theatrical venture, More Than You Deserve. Does the title sound familiar? I bet you can see where this is going. More Than You Deserve centers around a post-World War II and Vietnam War scenario that satirizes the horrors of war. This play is notable in the Steinman Cinematic Universe because this is the first time where Steinman and his good old pal Meat Loaf first met. Meat Loaf plays the role of a character named Rabbit and would later lead the two teaming up for Meat Loaf's most prolific album, but we're not quite there yet. Once again, I wasn't able to find a visual of the play, but I was lucky enough to find some full recordings of the musical on Steinman's site. I like how this website does a good job at cataloging some rare insider material, but goddamn is it difficult to navigate. The most notable of the songs in the play is obviously the title track More Than You Deserve, which was later released as a single by Meat Loaf and on his 1981 album Dead Ringer. Surprisingly, the only other notable song to come out of the Steinman venture was a song called Come With Me, We Know Love, which was later featured on Steinman's next play we're going to discuss, Neverland from 1977. Neverland features books, lyrics, and music all written by Steinman, and this is where we begin to see the Peter Pan-tinged fantasy elements begin to play a major part in his music. From what I could find, Neverland is a reworking of the aforementioned The Dream Engine, with characters like the Tribe being renamed to the Lost, and the Historian and Baal retaining their names with others simply having them change, as well as axing any scenes that contained any form of nudity. I know everyone is asking, and yes, this is the production that gave us the song Dance in My Pants, that would later be featured on Bad for Good. From the incomplete transcript I found, this seems to be a much cleaner version of The Dream Engine, and if anything, it shares more similarities with the Bat Out of Hell musical. I'm pretty sure most of us would agree that Meat Loaf's first collaboration with Steinman, Bat Out of Hell, contained songs that have a very theatrical quality to them. Well, you wouldn't be wrong because Neverland features nearly 60% of its material. All Revved Up with No Place to Go, Heaven Can Wait, and even Bat Out of Hell itself originate from this production. Neverland's version of Heaven Can Wait is interesting because it features the Hot Summer Night monologue in the middle of it. Who Needs the Young is featured here and originates from the Dream Engine. Come With Me, We Know Love from More Than You Deserve was reworked here as Midnight Serenade, and The Hunt appeared in some demos of Kid Champion, which is another Steinman play before Neverland that had lyrics and music written by him. I skipped over it simply because there's so little information retained about it. The two big pointers you need to know is that of all people, it starred Christopher Walken, even though it isn't featured on his Wikipedia page, so I'm not too confident about that, and it features For Crying Out Loud, which was later used in Bat Out of Hell and the Bat Out of Hell musical. Are you still there?
Alright, let's keep going. Chronologically moving on, we arrive at Meat Loaf's second album and first collaboration with Jim fucking Steinman, Bat Out of Hell. This is a spreadsheet I've been using throughout this video to document the chronology of the material, link below if you want to check it out. And yeah, Steinman had his work done for himself ahead of time, which props to him. The three original songs from the album are You Took the Words Right Out of My Mouth, Hot Summer Night, Two Out of Three Ain't Bad, and Paradise by the Dashboard Light. The question is, was it all worth it? Steinman accumulated all this materials for years and years only to refine them and have them professionally recorded. Did it pay off? The album sold 43 million copies and has gone platinum over 25 times in Australia alone. That's the point I want to make throughout this video. It doesn't matter how many rough drafts or trial and error it takes, if you keep at it, you too could sell 200,000 copies per year according to Wikipedia. The album's legacy was so impactful that it had an entire musical production made after its songs. It also kickstarted Meat Loaf's career and turned him into a household name pretty much overnight. Night. While the joint Steinman-Meat Loaf ventures wouldn't end here, for Steinman's next project, Meat Loaf would sit this one out due to immense vocal strain the Bat Out of Hell tour put on him. Steinman reworked what was meant to be Meat Loaf's next album, Renegade Angel, into his own solo venture as Bad for Good, in fear that these songs would never be heard. This is actually one of my favorite Steinman projects, and a good chunk of the album is sung by him, while the rest is sung by Rory Dodd. For everyone who doesn't know, Rory Dodd is a voice actor who has done many backing vocals for Meat Loaf songs. I could go on about the countless demos that Steinman and Dodd have done that, in my opinion, rival Meat Loaf singing, but that's not why we're here. Bad for Good sees only one reoccurring Steinman song, that being Dance in My Pants from Neverland. With an album full of fresh material, what can we expect to see in the future? The title track Bad for Good, which I think is a very underrated track, was only reused for its refrain? I'm not sure if that's the right word. Nowhere Fast, which I'll get to later, and the song was later covered by Meat Loaf on his 2006 album Bat Out of Hell 3. If you didn't know already, Meat Loaf does bounce back from his hiatus. Stark Raving Love is another underrated Steinman song that really wasn't reused for much other than being the origin of the ascending crescendo that was later used in Holding Out for a Hero. Surf's Up is later covered by Meat Loaf on his 1984 album Bad Attitude. Left in the Dark was later covered by Barbara Streisand on her 1984 album Emotions, and later covered by Meat Loaf on his 1995 album Welcome to the Neighborhood. I'm trying my hardest to spice this chronology up, but Meat Loaf just rules over it with an iron fist. The Storm is an instrumental piece that was included as a 7-inch single with the album, which originates from the Dream Engine and that Kid Champion play that I mentioned earlier, and later recycled for Opening of the Box on 1989's original Sin, and was used as the intro for Seize the Night on Bat Out of Hell 3, and briefly played during Wasted Youth from the Bat Out of Hell musical. I avoided half of the track listing for a reason, and that was to be able to finally use my patented Bat Out of Hell 2 Back in the Hell lightning round. You will be surprised at how few instances that I'm able to use that. Alright, let's go. Songs that appear on Bat Out of Hell 2. We got Lost Boys and Golden Girls, Out of the Frying Pan and Into the Fire, Love and Death in the American Guitar, renamed as Wasted Youth for the album, Rock and Roll Dreams Come Through, all those except Lost Boys and Golden Girls are covered in the Bat Out of Hell musical. Meat Loaf finally bounced back in 1981 with what I personally feel is an underrated album, Dead Ringer. Who would have guessed it? This album features all songs written by Jim Steinman. I think it's because his name isn't plastered on the cover that people don't give it as much credit as it deserves. This album features all original songs by Steinman, as well as a re-recorded version of More Than You Deserve from that musical Meat Loaf was in that we mentioned earlier. Dead Ringer for Love was a big single off this album and was featured in the Bat Out of Hell musical. That's it? Nocturnal Pleasure is another monologue performed by Steinman that is used as dialogue in the Bat Out of Hell musical. I don't know, I guess I was expecting something more at this point. Alright, moving on. In 1984, Steinman created the impromptu band Fire Inc., which sounds badass as fuck, for the movie Streets of Fire. With a movie that labels itself as a rock and roll fable and features this many motorcycles, did you not expect them to get a half chub for this project? Under Fire Inc., Steinman contributed two songs to the Streets of Fire soundtrack, those being Nowhere Fast and Tonight Is What It Means to Be Young. Both songs are bangers, by the way. Nowhere Fast reuses the Godspeed lyric exchange used on Bad for Good, and the song itself would later be covered by Meat Loaf for his 1984 album Bad Attitude, while Tonight Is What It Means to Be Young is entirely original and was made popular in Japan by Japanese artist Megumi Shina. Yes, Jim fucking Steinman is Mr. Worldwide. The song was later reworked into that German play that I mentioned at the very beginning of the video, Tanz der Vampire. More on that coming up in a sec. I am well aware that this video is just one big rabbit hole, and if you made it this far, then it's too late to dig yourself back up. In 1989, Steinman assembled the all-girl pop group Pandora's Box, and together they released only one album, Original Sin. Objectively Creatively, the album was a commercial failure, but it did serve as a catalyst for many Steinman songs that will later be repurposed. Starting off, the opening monologue, The Invocation, was used as dialogue in the Battle of Helm musical. The title track, Original Sin, The Natives Are Restless Tonight, was later covered by Taylor Dane and Meat Loaf, and its instrumental was repurposed for many tracks on Tanz der Vampire. Requiem Metal is an instrumental piece that was later reused as a backing track to Steinman's Wasted Youth monologue on Battle of Hell 2. Steinman's second monologue on this album, I've Been Dreaming Up a Storm Lately, is more of a refined draft of similar monologues seen in the aforementioned Dream Engine and Neverland productions. It's All Coming Back to Me Now was later made more famous by Celine Dion and later used in the Bad NFL musical as well as Bad NFL 3. Good Girls Go to Heaven, Bad Girls Go Everywhere was originally recorded by aforementioned Japanese artist Megumi Shina and later included on Bad NFL 2 and the Bad NFL musical. The Want Ad is another monologue piece that originates from the Dream Engine and Neverland. Prelude, I see what they did there, is a piano solo melody of Original Sin, It's All Coming Back to Me Now, and It Just Won't Quit, that originate from the same album actually. And lastly, The Future Ain't What It Used to Be was later covered by Meat Loaf on Battle of Hell 3. Next up, I have a group of various songs I wanted to quickly discuss while I still can before we dive into more of Steinman's radical theatrics. For example, there are two different versions of A Kiss is a Terrible Thing to Waste with different lyrical and musical content. The first version was performed by the Everly Brothers in 1984 and features the backing track of Out of the Frying Pan and Into the Fire and original lyrics by Steinman exclusive to this version of the song, which is also a fucking rager, I'm not gonna lie. The second version of A Kiss is a Terrible Thing to Waste was at the forefront of Andrew Lloyd Webber's Whistle Down the Wind, which, by the way, Steinman also helped write the lyrics and music for, although there isn't anything interesting to make note of for this video. There is a song entitled More from the Sisters of Mercy 1990 album Vision Thing, which is the only song produced by Steinman, and it shares musical similarities to a scrapped Batman musical he briefly worked on. In that production, it was titled The Catwoman Song. I honestly wish I had more information about that Batman musical because it's the most left field venture in this entire video. Surprisingly, as far as I can tell, most of the songs Steinman has collaborated on with Bonnie Tyler have rarely been repurposed by Steinman. Loving You is a Dirty Job But Someone's Gotta Do It was later covered by Mr. Meaty on Braver Than We Are, and Total Eclipse of the Heart ties into that example used at the very beginning of the video and was repurposed into Totale Finsternis for Tanz der Vampire and features lyrical similarities with Coming Tonight from the Dream Engine. Speaking of Tanz der Vampire, or Dance of the Vampires as I'll start referring to it as, Steinman wrote the music and lyrics for the play and it features a lot of Steinman's previous discography. The play seemingly has a fetish with Original Sin from Pandora's Box and uses its instrumental for two of its songs. The Overture uses The Storm from Bad for Good, In the Crypt uses its instrumental from Who Needs the Young from the Dream Engine, Eternity and The Ballroom borrow their instrumentals from Gods from Neverland, or Gods Z from Braver Than We Are. The Insatiable Greed is a repurposed version of Objects in a Rearview Mirror May Appear Closer Than They Are from Bad NFL 2. Fuck, these titles are so long. More famously, Tonight Is What It Means to Be Young was repurposed into the play's finale song, The Dance of the Vampires. It's just so weird having known this song from Streets of Fire for so long only to see a bunch of dancing vampires flailing their arms and talking about how they're going to take over the world and drink my blood. And by repurposed, I mean the words were definitely changed. I've got a dream about an angel on the beach and the perfect waves are starting to come. His hair is flying out in ribbons of gold and his touch has got the power to stun was changed to, I've got a dream that a vampire in a castle is dying and is dust in the wind, but his vision won't be ended and it's coming to pass that a new world is about to begin. A very radical departure to say the least. Next up, we have two more Meat Loaf albums, which I'm going to speed through because there isn't much new to discuss with these two that I haven't brought up before. In 2006, Meat Loaf released Battle of Hell 3, The Monster Is Loose, which is a controversial album amongst fans, and there are a couple reasons for this. For starters, the first two Battle of Hell albums prominently feature songs by Jim Steinman on the front cover, which, by the way, is the biggest dick energy I've seen in my dad rock collection. And the third one doesn't. Why is that? Because half of the album wasn't written by or feature any production credits from Uncle Jim. This also stirred drama because Jim fucking Steinman owns the trademark for the Battle of Hell name, and I'm assuming material too, but hey, at least we got a fat shoutout in the liner notes. Fans disregard this album as part of the Battle of Hell legacy, and I'm no Fantano, but it is pretty mid. Here's a visual of all the origins of the songs featured on this album that Steinman wrote for him. No new material here except I haven't mentioned the song If It Ain't Broke, Break It, which originates from the 2003 MTV adaptation of Wuthering Heights, and Steinman contributed three songs to that project. Moving Moving on, Loaf of Meat and Jimmy became bubble buddies again for 2016's Braver Than We Are, which, by the way, is Meat Loaf's latest album as of recording this video. All of the songs were written by Steinman for this album, and by that I mean his name is back on the front of the cover. For this album, we're treated to 4 original songs, and I put original with an asterisk because these songs originated from various demos, workshops, and live recordings to my knowledge. Who Needs the Young and School of Your Country is from The Dream Engine. Going All the Way, a song in 6 movements, features mild instrumental elements from Outside is Freedom from Dance of the Vampires. The track More confuses me even more because it's technically a Sisters of Mercy cover but was produced by Steinman and appears in the Batman musical, so it's technically a Steinman song at that point, right? At this point it might as well be. Loving You is a Dirty Job But Someone Has to Do It is a cover of the Bonnie Tyler song Steinman wrote, and the aforementioned God Z is from Neverland. At the time of releasing this album, Steinman was 69, nice, and at this point in his career he had run out of ways to recycle his old back catalog, and with Meat Loaf's vocal range dwindling, Steinman decided to hang up the towel. And that's exactly what didn't happen. Jim fucking Steinman's Bad NFL musical had its first premiere in Manchester, London on February 17th, 2017. And he's still putting his name at the forefront of the advertising, what a total Chad. This is one of the few plays I've been able to find a full recording of for this video, and after viewing it, it's pretty damn great. And I already know what you're thinking. Richard, how are you able to watch a play that hasn't had a US tour due to a current world event and use footage from it?
Well, don't worry about it.
The Bad NFL musical was about a rebel teenager and his squad protesting the tyrannical ruler of the town. The rebel teenager falls in love with a girl who coincidentally is the tyrannical ruler's daughter. When they fall in love, the tyrannical ruler kills the rebel teenager over protesting the taxation on urination. Wait, this is the plot to Urinetown? No, but seriously, it's a rock and roll tinge retelling of Peter Pan. The main character Strat and his amigos are named the Lost, and there is literally a character named Tink. And yes, the story does share many of the same story beats as Urinetown the musical, just pointing that out. On a side note, I just want to mention the choreography of the play for a second. I know it's hard to choreograph an 8-minute rock epic about a motorcycle crash, but every time I see this, I can't help but think about my boy Karel B. Anyways, after watching the Bad NFL musical, I couldn't help but feel moved by it. Not that the plot drove me to tears or anything, but having my prior knowledge of the song's origins, and after doing all the research for this video, knowing how many years of trial and error, version after version, cover after cover, it was inspiring to see it all accumulate into one big work of art, for lack of a better word. Except for arguably what part of my body hurts the most, there aren't any original songs throughout the book of the show. This is what the entirety of the video was building up to, and being able to look back at how many different iterations and versions these songs went through to get to this point is incredibly interesting and inspiring, to say the least. I'll admit, I just wanted an outlet to discuss this play and various other works from one of my favorite composers of all time. The songs in this play don't feel disjointed or forced into the play for the sake of having Steinman songs in it. These songs greatly contribute to the plot and really push the plot forward. The musical so cohesively intertwines the songs into it that it feels like this is the outlet the songs were meant to exist in the first place. Reflecting back through all the various recordings of these songs and seeing how they changed throughout time, it is really inspiring to see Steinman finalize his magnum opus. Steinman had all the pieces of the puzzle for decades, probably scattered around the house, and that last piece your bastard little brother hid underneath the couch that took you years to find was this musical. Thank God he found that puzzle piece.
I would like to note that the Steinman story does eventually come full circle. If you haven't noticed, which is impossible with the footage I've been using, the shirt the main character Strat wears features Steinman performing as Ball in The Dream Engine, his first production. That shirt is so badass, by the way. Please, I want someone to print that so bad. Take my money. The actor who played Strat in the original run of the play, Andrew Pollock, would later play Steinman's character Ball in the 50-year anniversary production of The Dream Engine, which also featured much of the original cast from all those years ago returning to reprise their roles, minus the nudity. I would like to thank the people on the other end of my internet connection for making this video possible. Jim Steinman's back catalog is archived and documented by some really hardcore and dedicated fans. Without them, this video would probably be about 5 minutes in length. I apologize for not having exact links to every source I've deprived information from to create this video. That's my mistake. I will try to link as much as I can remember in the description below, as well as link that spreadsheet that I used to help create this video. I also would like to apologize if I missed anything in this video. Steinman's catalog is so diverse, it would be immensely difficult to go over every little detail in depth, as well as make it interesting. I hope you found this video entertaining. This video was the literal definition of going down a rabbit hole, and I hope everyone found it at least enjoyable and took away anything from this video. Thank you so much for watching, and have a nice day.